Vaishnava Vrindaki Jai Nama Charna. चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासवी घोर भक्त वृंद की जय। श्री श्री राधा कृष्ण गोपी गोपीनाथ श्याम कुंदर कुं गिरि गोवर्धन की जय। वृंदावन धाम की जय। मायापुर धाम की जय। नवदीप धाम की जय। जगन्नाथपुरी धाम की जय। गंगमाई की जय। जानमाई की जय। भक्ति देवी की जय। जस्सी देवी की जय। समवेत भक्त वृंद की जय। घोर प्रेम नंद
nature, which works under the supervision of the Supreme Lord. The materialistic person has no knowledge that ultimately he is under the control of Krishna. The person in false ego takes all credit for doing everything independently, and that is a symptom of his nescience. He does not know that this gross and subtle body is the creation of material nature under the order of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and as such, his bodily and mental activities should be engaged in the service of Krishna, in Krishna consciousness. The ignorant man forgets that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is known as Rishikesha, or the master of the senses of the material body, but due to his long misuse of the senses and sense gratification, he is factually bewildered of the false ego, which makes him forget his eternal relationship with Krishna. Telling us all about this wonderful devotee named Prabhupada. And some little girl who was hearing all about Prabhupada. I remember one day, one program, this little girl went into ecstasy. She just went, Prabhupada! 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 In ecstasy. Little girl in ecstasy. So, Prabhupada, you know what Prabhupada said? He said, if you think of me, I am there. That's why I wanted to talk about him a little bit. Because by thinking of Prabhupada, he's actually here with us. This is even physically present during those years up to 1977. He's also here now. And if we take his instructions very, very seriously, he will shower his mercy upon us like torrents of rain in the monsoon season in India. So let us take this Prabhupada Sangha, which is available in these wonderful purports. I was just hearing as we were coming across the island today, Prabhupada is explaining how important it is to have the association of the pure devotee, of the guru. Prabhupada explained the Dao Garakshrayam. The very first step is to take shelter of the bona fide spiritual master. Prabhupada was explaining, unless you approach the Vedic wisdom through the mercy of the guru, you cannot even understand it. It remains incomprehensible. Prabhupada compared it to this. You have a jar of honey, and you're licking the outside of the jar. Are you getting any honey? No. You're wanting honey, but you're not getting it because you're foolishly licking the outside of the jar. But when one takes shelter of the one of my spiritual master, then the lid comes off and the tongue is down there in a minute. You understand? This is what Prabhupada was saying. I was hearing him. He was so nicely explaining this point. So if you all want to become the devotees of Krishna, you have to have a guru. You have to become a disciple of a bona fide spiritual master. Not just officially, I'm initiated, but I do all nonsense. No, you have to become sold out servantly spiritual master. Now some foolish devotees, so-called devotees, argue that only Prabhupada is the guru, nobody else is the guru. It's called Vritic philosophy. This is completely false because Krishna says, Evam param param praptam, imam nirdarshaya vidu, sakaneneya mahata yoganashta parantapa. This knowledge was thus received in the chain of Pacific succession, and the saintly kings understood it in that way that in due course of time the succession was broken, and thus the science of it appeared to be lost. So this Vedic philosophy means they want to break the Pacific succession and lose the knowledge. They want to break it again. Prabhupada said that one who is now the disciple, he becomes the next spiritual master. These Vedics, they say, well, you can't be a guru. It's wrong to be a guru. But it's really interesting to know, Prabhupada even personally told me in one letter, instead of speaking of guru, Prabhupada told me I could aspire to become a Jagat Guru, the spiritual master of the whole universe. But to speak of just a guru, Prabhupada said, Jagat Guru, I could aspire like that. So when these Vedic people say only Prabhupada is a guru, I just laugh or I feel sorry for them. Because Prabhupada clearly established that his devotees would become the gurus when he departed. Just like in the final days in Vrindavan, he says, now this condition I will stop initiating, and you all can initiate. He repeated, one man, that Gali gentleman, become a disciple of his disciple. Even when Prabhupada was living, he repeated that. So we have to understand through the system of the succession is not that you can jump over the spiritual master to the previous acharya. That's what these Vritti people want to do. They want to jump over the acharya that Prabhupada has established and think in this way they can connect with Prabhupada, but actually they're disconnecting themselves with Prabhupada, from Prabhupada by doing this. So we have to understand through the Pacific succession system This is how we get the awakening of loving God within our hearts. Awakening of loving God is a very, very great treasure. So once you go about it in the proper way, not according to one's concocted idea, once you follow this exactly what Prabhupada is stating in these books. So today we're looking at a very wonderful verse, one of the key verses actually. The difference between the devotee and the non-devotee. The devotee feels himself simply an instrument. Just like Arjuna, he felt himself simply the instrument on that battlefield of affliction. Simply be the instrument. He doesn't think, yes, I'm a great Arjuna, I'm a great this, I'm a great that. No, I'm just a humble servant of the loving Lord Krishna. Whatever he orders me to do, whatever he empowers me to do, that I will do for his pleasure. This is the mood we all should have as devotees. But whatever order I'm given by my spiritual master, let me carry it out to the best of my ability, depending on his mercy. In the mercy of the previous acharya, the mercy of Guru Gauranga, that I can, the mercy of God and Krishna, that I can be successful by their grace in executing this duty. So our duty is to become the pure devotees of Krishna and to make the whole world Krishna conscious. So we have this dual duty as we sing every morning in the Shinga prayers. Bhagir Nasimha Hidaye Nasimha. May Lord Shrinidhe dwell within my heart, killing all of my bad propensities, so let my mind become completely clean and I can bring peace to the entire world. So this is our meditation. I want to completely purify my heart. I want to make a spiritual revolution within my heart. Make a spiritual revolution in the world around me by telling everybody about Krishna. That is Lord Chaitanya's order. Yadi deva tahe ka Krishna upadesha marangaya guru haryatare devesh. Try to tell everyone about Krishna, wherever you go. You see, this is our duty given by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We want to awaken the whole world with Krishna consciousness. The more that we endeavor to do this as a loving service to Srila Prabhupada, to our spiritual masters, to Guru, to Lord Chaitanya, Lord Nityananda, Sri Shivada and Krishna, the more our lives become glorious, the more we become blessed with bliss. There's no reason to be in any type of anxiety. Krishna consciousness needs no anxiety. If you're actually properly practicing Krishna consciousness, that means you have no anxiety at all. Except for one anxiety, that is how to save these poor souls who are caught up in the cycle of birth and death. If you have any anxiety other than delivering the fallen souls of this world back to home by the Godhead, you're mine. You're not Krishna conscious. So we have to learn how to actually be Krishna conscious. We have to learn how to actually become Krishna conscious. That my only duty is to please my beloved spiritual master, that my thoughts, my words, my deeds, in all times, places, and circumstances. I live simply to please my spiritual master. That is my only business. This is what Prabhupada taught us. This is what we learned how to do when Prabhupada was on this planet, teaching us and guiding us. We knew we had to do everything to please Prabhupada. Whatever Prabhupada wants, that's it. What I want, not very important. What does Prabhupada want me to do? How does Prabhupada want me to think? How does Prabhupada want me to speak? How does Prabhupada want me to act? That's the training we got. And those devotees have stepped tightly to that training. They are now senior devotees on this planet, great spiritual leaders. We've got so many great advanced devotees visit Mauritius, this kind of leaders, you see, because they stuck to this principle. My every thought, my every word, my every deed in all times, places, and circumstances must be for the pleasure of my spiritual master. This is such an important point, Krishna confirms it. He says, Yeme bhakta jana bhakta, na me bhakta sadayana, ma bhaktanam chiye bhaktas, te me bhakta tama. My dear Arjuna, the one who is my devotee, not my devotee, is not my devotee, but the devotee, my devotee of the devotee of Krishna. So how much are you dedicated to your spiritual master? Or do you even have one? You should choose a spiritual master, fully surrender unto him, because that's when Krishna will recognize, yes, now this person is actually my devotee. They've taken shelter of the spiritual master, they're living their lives fully dedicated to pleasing the spiritual master, and they're living thought, word, and deed in all times, places, and circumstances. Therefore, I recognize them as being my bona fide devotee, and I shower unlimited mercy upon them every minute. So it's our choice, we can be in Maya or we can be Krishna conscious. And we have to also learn from the senior Vaishnavas what it actually means to be Krishna conscious. Not some concocted idea of semi-Krishna consciousness. We need to know what is actual pure bhakti so we can cultivate that pure bhakti in all times, places, and circumstances, at the temple, at home, while shopping, at work, in school, in the commute, in every situation, we have to be cultivating pure devotional service. There's a special mantra for doing that. Prabhupada emphasized this mantra a lot. In fact, he made it the whole basis. It's coming from Lord Chaitanya, the whole basis of our movement. Is this mantra begging for pure devotional service. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Rama. Hare Rama. Rama Rama.
Don't just chant in Canada like some ritual. Now you're connecting with Krishna. This and that, you get on the telephone with Krishna. You can actually ring him up on your smartphone and say, Krishna, please bless me with pure devotional service. And Krishna says, yes, you're begging and I will bless you with pure devotional service. So Hare Krishna mantra is better than a smartphone. It's free. There's no permanent charges. And you don't have to worry about having a good connection, because if you're sincere, you're connected. Just be a sincere devotee of Krishna and beg him, my dear Lord, please give me pure devotional service. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Rama. Hare Rama. Rama Rama. Hare.
If we're chanting the proper mood, with each mantra we go deeper and deeper and deeper into the nectar of devotion. If we chant properly, then we get more mercy, with each mantra. More and more mercy flooding upon us and completely driving away, purifying us from all the lust, the anger, the greed, the madness, the illusion, the envy that is plaguing us for millions and billions and trillions and quadrillions of lifetimes in this material existence. You are most fortunate, my dear ladies and gentlemen and kids. You are most fortunate that now you have the human form of life, and you're even more fortunate that you've come in contact with Krishna consciousness. So all I can do is fall at your feet and beg you, my dear ladies, gentlemen, and kids, please take this process seriously and make your lives unlimitedly sublime. So now I can answer any questions, myself and Guru Maharaj, we will answer questions. Okay. You can give some of her also, not just me. You can give this one to Guru Maharaj. I'll tell you. There's a bottom of 50-50. Mythic has a strategy to influence the newcomers to Islam. Ray, would you kindly advise on how to be away from Mythic? Maybe you could train the devotees. I mean, it's actually quite silly because Prabhupada clearly established this that my disciples, they will also become spiritual masters. It's really, even named 11 devotees who start initiating disciples. And he said, they will be this devotees that believe in Brahmananda, these would be your disciples, Prabhupada, and just doing it on your behalf. Prabhupada said, no, but they'll be the disciples of my disciples, and they're very clear. Now that they're initiating people on Prabhupada's behalf, who initiated with Prabhupada's disciple, no. Prabhupada said they'd be disciples of my disciples, and they're very clear. So we have to be convinced of this, and we have to preach it, that these spiritual masters of ISKCON, they are authorized by Srila Prabhupada to become spiritual masters and take their own disciples. That is how the secret succession has gone on at the beginning of the universe. Prabhupada is the one who is now the disciple, he becomes the next spiritual master. And you also, if you are purely following this process, after your guru departs, you may also be initiating disciples. You see, that's how it works. And your disciples can initiate disciples. In this way, it works. It goes on. The secret succession. So one just has to be very sober and very dedicated, cultivating true devotional service in your only business. What will be the position of the followers of this? They won't go back to Godhead. They commit so many Vaishnava Brahmas. They will be condemned to bodies and self existence. Okay, Guru Maharaj?
I got the ladies of the devotees. They are honorable. They are honorable. What is it? Bad and good. So the devotees' first quality is to receive all the bad and good qualities. Because Nirvana, and surrender fully to Guru and Vishnu. That's the best quality of the devotees. Otherwise, there are innumerable qualities mentioned in chapter 2, chapter 13 of Bhagavad Gita, so please read there.
Next question. I need more questions, otherwise, we'll begin the lecture. What is the difference between Vedic mantra chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra? Hare Krishna is Vedic mantra. Why do you think there's some difference? It is also Vedic. It is the topmost of all Vedic mantras. There are many, many mantras, but this is called Mahamantra. This is the king of all mantras. If you can master this particular mantra, and you've mastered all the mantras. Nothing has to learn this mantra, that mantra, this mantra, that mantra, so many mantras. Simply learn how to chant Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Three many princes. And you'll be in direct contact with Radha and Krishna every minute. So don't think this is not Vedic mantra. This is the highest level of all Vedic mantras.
What is the fate of the devotee who does not remember or utter the word Krishna when living the body, living his body? If one has chanted the Hare Krishna Mahamantra throughout their life, there is no question that he won't be. The devotee will be erupting, he will not be. Krishna said whatever the devotees have, he preserves it, and whatever they lack, at the time of death, he reminds them. So if you are the devotee, the first thing is not automatically wondering that you remember Krishna at the time of death. So that is the reason you have to practice chanting of Hare Krishna all the time. Which question is it?
It is said that lust stays till the final breath. How to fight this disease? Well, I don't agree with that saying. That's only for materialists. You can kick out all lust right now. You don't have to wait till the time of death to kick it out. Mr. Lust, you're not rubbing my heart anymore. You have an unwanted guest in your house. What do? You feed him? No, you don't feed an unwanted guest. I don't feed it, it'll go away eventually. I have to eat somewhere. So if I don't feed it, I'm wanting guests, so I have to go somewhere else to eat. So Mr. Lusk is an unwanted guest in your heart, so don't feed him. That's the key. There's a great Vaishnavacharya, Jumanacharya Avandra, South India. He was formerly a king, and he had a harem. There was so much sex pleasure, he had a lot of girls. Harem means sex pleasure. So now he's become a sadhu, he's given up that sex life. But sometimes he remembers those days with all those girls enjoying sexual intercourse with him. He thinks of those things and he goes, this is not good. I shouldn't be thinking these things. So he gave a very nice poetry in this connection.
Yadavadi mama cheta Krishna tadara hinde Navarana rasanam kalam
Sadavadi bhaktanari sangane smayamane Tapati mukuru vikara nishwamsha. Ever since I've been engaged in the Chandra loving service as Sri Sri Radha and Krishna, relishing dava dava rasa, ever increasing taste in that service, whenever due to my past nefarious activities as a king with that harem, I think of having sex with all those girls. My lips curl with distaste and I spit at the thought. So if you become a very good spitter, you can clear your heart now. You don't have to worry about the time of death. You clear it out now. So how do you become solid in that? You have to get the eye of taste.
Vishaya vinivartante nirvaharashinehina
vachavasham nushokyatvabharamushnanivartate. The invited soul may be mistreated in sense enjoyment, though taste the sense object remains, but ceasing such engagements by getting a higher taste, he is fixed in consciousness. So you don't have to worry about being tormented by lust at the time of death. You simply have to learn how to get to that higher taste right here, right now, by intensely chanting Hare Krishna mantra under the guidance and blessings of the bona fide spiritual master. And then you will lose that attraction for this lusty so-called enjoyments, which is simply torturing the soul. There's no real happiness, it's simply a torture, pulling them back into bodily consciousness. It's simply nature's arrangement that somehow we will propagate the species. But other than that, it's simply a distraction. You should not give in to this lust, you should become free from it, spit it about it, that is a good success. Yeah. Actually, one particle of Mahaprasad can liberate you from psyche living there. That is the great power of Mahaprasad. Even one little tiny grain of rice can liberate you from this material existence. Someone who has eaten Mahaprasad and is guaranteed to get at least a human body in his next life, and that depends on his consciousness. If he takes one glove down, the moment of death, you remember that glove down. You become a devotee in his next life. It depends on how one remembers that prasadam.
This is a question for you, but I would say something that I really think. When I was questioning that, Guru Dev Hare Krishna, could you kindly share your personal realization? I wonder if this devotee who wrote the question while he's sitting in a class, is hearing the class, or he was sleeping. Because he just revealed the realization that he had.
What is the difference between this kind and Gaudiya Math? Gaudiya Math is an institution created by Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakura. The difference between this kind and Gaudiya Math is that the Gaudiya Math disintegrated after Bhakti Siddhanta's disappearance. They disobeyed his order to work together cooperatively, every sannyasi started his own independent Gaudiya Math. If there is no such thing as the Gaudiya Math, there's all these little tiny splinter groups of the Gaudiya Math. So the Gaudiya Math created by Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakura does not exist. Just little fragments of it are here and there. So the Gaudiya Math is not one institution. It does not maintain itself as part of the order of Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakura. But this kind has, in spite of all of our struggles we go through, ISKCON has remained a unified movement. Only some rascals like the Vipics have split off, but they're not part of us. We all answer to the GEC, the Governing Body Commission. We all accept their, we all appreciate their guidance and their blessing, and we act under their direction. This is how we're a unified movement all over the world, under the GEC. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati ordered them to order to form a GEC, but they neglected to follow his instruction. That is the difference between this kind and Gaudiya Math. Gaudiya Math disobeyed the order of the spiritual master, whereas this kind is obeyed the order of the spiritual master. That's the difference.
You all speak English here or not? You speak English? Understand English? A lot of devotees understand English, or they're just polite and say English. And the language they don't understand. What's the answer? They didn't answer the question because they don't understand what I'm saying. Some like sidelines to the lecture, everybody else is polite, they're saying it. You speak English?
Yes.
No?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Any of the local devotees have questions. Only my disciples are asking questions.